today, I want to talk to you about something that has been a bit of a growing thing in my own life. And it's something that I've been conscious of over the years of my journey with the Lord. But it's something I'm being more intentional about. Just in September, I celebrated my 40th year in ministry. It was 45 years following Jesus, 40 years in ministry. And I did some reflecting on that day and just thinking about what have I learned, what are takeaways as I press into the best years now of my life, what are the things that I can carry into it? And this is the thing that bubbles to the top. Enjoying God. Enjoying God. And I find oftentimes as followers of Jesus, we get busy in life doing things for God that we oftentimes don't take the time to enjoy him. And a lot of this got triggered for me when I was a boy growing up in the Lutheran church in the state of Minnesota. And there was a time we lived in California and Arizona and then in Minnesota, but it was the Lutheran theme was part of the heritage of my family. And one of our pastors took me through catechism. Did any of you guys do that growing up, catechism? Yeah, okay, so there's a few of you. And, you know, which was a process for like a 12 or 13-year-old to walk through certain foundations of the faith. And in the Lutheran church, one of the quotes that you hear is this. It's the purpose of life or the meaning of life is to glorify God and enjoy him forever. You know, it's like we could just close in prayer now after that, all right? The meaning of life, to glorify God, which glorifying God means to enhance the reputation of God in the eyes of other people. It's not enhancing God, but have you noticed God's reputation of who he is sometimes has been torn down. And glorifying God is enhancing his reputation in the eyes of other people by the way you live, by the way you relate to people, by the way you're the best employee someone's ever had or the best boss, you know, that kind of thing. So there's the glorifying God, but then there's also the other part, enjoying him forever. And that's going to be one of the things that we get to do with our lives in heaven, is we're going to glorify him, but we're also going to enjoy him forever. So I want to talk with you today a little bit about this area of what does it mean to enjoy God. So I want us to look at the scriptures here in a few minutes, and then I want to give you five really practical ways that I've been exercising in my life and continue to exercise to make it practical in my daily life to enjoy God. Remember that God has made us relational. He's made us relational. He didn't just make you to fulfill a purpose, although that's true. He didn't make you just to exist or to suck up the air that he created. He made you actually first and foremost to enjoy him. He wants you to enjoy him. Have you ever been on the other end of enjoyment where you're the one being enjoyed? I've been enjoying this in my relationship with my grandkids, particularly my oldest, Baron, who's just about ready to hit 4. And Cheryl will tease me and she'll say, do you see how much Baron enjoys you? You know, last time when I was here, I think I did this too. I one of Baron's things. You know, and so when Papa does the Donald Duck sneeze or when we do, you know, we wrestle around and we play baseball or whatever, and I can tell in his little face, it's a really cool, meaningful moment that he's just enjoying being with Papa. And I'm investing in his life a lot. And part of that is I wanna be in his life when he gets to be that 13-year-old and there's maybe this little double beat in his heart for this young gal and he can't tell mom and dad yet about it, he can tell Papa. You know? And just building relationship. I want to be there when he starts wrestling through things in life that I can still be there. But as I build relationship, that will happen. And so as he enjoys me, I enjoy him very, very much. God wants us to enjoy him. Now, let me just start with this, and I want you to see this. How do you tend to relate to God? Look at this slide here. How do you tend to relate to God? And if God's intention is for us to relate to him well, how do you relate to him? So look at, again, these are just suggestions. Is he like an orchestra conductor in your life? You know, stay with the beat or you'll see his scowl. In other words, just keep, look, just read your Bible, man. Pray, and if you don't, he kind of gives you the look. Sometimes that's how we see God. You know, the image of God we carry inside of us affects how we live our daily lives. If you've never thought about that before, I really want to encourage you, give time to that. The image of God that you carry inside of you, however it got there, it affects how you live every day. See, when things collapse around you, if you don't know God's character and who he is, you see, and you see what the Bible says about him, and that's how you live. Fear dominates. Scrambling just to grab something to survive. There's not trust because you don't know him. And one of the things that makes me really sad is I find a lot of Christians know a lot more about God than they actually know him. That makes me really sad because I think it also makes God sad. Like he didn't make us just to fulfill some cosmic destiny, though there's a destiny. But he made us, like he made you, to have a relationship with him. How much time do you actually give to that in your life? So again, is God the orchestra conductor? How about this one? Is God the coach? You know, it's never quite good enough. Man, you did good, but you could have. And is that your walk with God? It's like, you know a little bit of God's affirmation, but there's always, yeah, but you should have done these, you know? How about, is he the insurance agent? Like a good neighbor, God is there. You know, you just draw on God in times of need. It's like, if you're really honest with your heart, it's like you don't have a regular relationship with God. It's just when you're needy that your prayer life accelerates. Okay? How about the absent dad? He's too busy, not interested, or he's just unavailable. Is that how you see God? He's just kind of out there somewhere, but there's not a heart connect with him. What about Santa Claus? God just really exists to simply grant you your every wish. Sometimes that's what we think God is like. Or he's the ringmaster. We must keep performing so you can stay on his good side. Do the right Christian thing, otherwise God gets ticked off. How about the employer? The reason you're faithful to God is because of the benefits. Don't have to worry about going to hell. That's a good benefit. God says he loves me. That's a good benefit. But there's no real relationship. And sometimes that's the way we are with employers at times. We love the benefits we get. We get paid. We get our insurance. We get vacation time. But is there any real relationship? I want you to think about that with God. Or is he the love of your life? Is he the love of your life? I have a physical love of my life and my wife, Cheryl, that Bill spoke of. We're on year 36 of our marriage. I love her more today than when I married her. And she is the love of my life. I love her very, very much. But do you also understand that the church is the love of Jesus's life? It's his bride. The Bible says that the church is the bride of Christ. I was telling the C3ers yesterday that if somebody came up to me and started talking really badly about my bride, I would love them and hit them in the mouth. And I want us to be reminded that sometimes we can just kind of throw grenades at the church. Look, if you're going to criticize the church, you got to remember who you're talking about. So let it be with compassion and a way to fix it. Maybe with some tears in your eyes, recognizing, because when Jesus looks at his church, his eyes dance. We are the love of his life. And he invites us to make him the love of our lives. Is he that for you? I want to challenge you in that today to think about that. So let me ask you a question, and I'm asking you to chime in here with me. So what do you really enjoy? What do you really enjoy, like doing in life? All right, like for me, trips to Hawaii because I live there, awesome little beach time, little Kahlua pig from the luau's, little guava juice is always the will of God. You know, a good Minnesota Vikings win, always the will of God. Yet, I told the last service I'm a diehard Viking fan, which just means I diehard every single year. All right, but there will be a day. So it's caused me to grow great in character and faith by being a Vikings fan. So, but let me ask you this, what do you guys enjoy? So several of you just shout out to me, like, what are things you just really enjoy? Like you get a day off or you're on vacation. What are stuff that's like, just lights you up? What do you enjoy? Shout at me. What's that?
Hiking.
Food. Another thing that's the will of God. Yeah, food. What else? What's that back here?
Video games.
Yeah. All right. What else? What's that? Yeah, yeah. Fast cars. I was seeing what you were doing, and I was trying to interpret the mime there. Fast cars. Oh, really? I guess we need to kind of be following her out of church today, don't we? Wow, that's awesome. Fast cars. We didn't hear that one in the last service. All right, what else?
Baseball.
Roller coasters. Dancing. All right, so we got these things that we enjoy, all right? And the word enjoy means these two things that you're seeing on the screen. It means delightfully satisfying, and it also means hitting the mark. That's what it means, like, man, that just hit the mark. Like the other day, I told Sonia Bearson, who's on our team. Sonia and Darren are on our lion's share staff, and they're actually... We're a part of this church, and I met them through Bill and Lisa, and they're kind of on loan, I think, to me. But the other day, I was out hitting golf balls. It was a Monday. I had a day off, and so I enjoy golf, and so I'm hitting golf balls. And I said, I think I had a South Korean angel appear to me, because I'm in my little lane, you know, kind of driving balls, and there's a young guy here. He's done, and two over is this South Korean guy, about the same age as me, and he's hitting it long and hard and straight, and I'm doing all right, but then I get my 5-iron out, and it's like, what happened, you know? And then I take the 3-wood out and teeing some up and hitting them, and it's a hit and miss, literally, you know? I'm not missing, but I'm just missing the mark big time. Well, this South Korean guy says, I had purchased a bucket of balls. Well, he comes over and says, hey, you might want these. Like, I think you need more practice, you know? And drops off 40 more balls to me, and this is why I have a Band-Aid on my hand today, because I had a blister, because I faithfully hit those other 40 balls. But here he comes to me in broken English, and he says, you know what you're doing wrong. And I said, no, obviously I don't, because it... And he said, your swing... I have a swing, the way I was trained, it's called an athletic swing. It's just a basic, you know, swing. He said, what you're doing is you're going back, and you're hitching right here. And he said, just don't. He said, just do what you were normally doing. And you guys, I teed it up. I am not kidding you. A 3-wood... 225 yards in the air, straight as an arrow, 8 straight times. And I looked at this guy and says, who are you? Is your name Gabriel? You know, who are you? And then he says, oh, I have one more thing. And he said this, that you will need. And I thought, see, this is an angel. You will need this. And so I said, what is it? So he says, oh, let me show you. Ball under tree, can't hit out. Let me show. And so he puts the ball here in front of this back foot, and he leans all his weight here. He says, now take 5-iron, hit, like this, strike it. And sure enough, man, boom, the thing went 150 yards, 10 feet off the ground. He said, oh, you shoot good. You know, and he just says, oh, have a good day. And I'm going, Jesus, did you just send me like South Korean angel, you know? So tomorrow when I get home and I have a day off, I'm going to go practice both of those things really, really well. See, that's something that I could enjoy, and when I started hitting the mark, I enjoyed it even more, okay? So these are things that we have in your life. Let me show you a picture of something that, again, hits the mark in my life. So throw this picture up. So these are my grandkids. So I have 3 of them. So on your left, you're going to see Baron. Baron's almost 4, and like one of his highlights last year was being at our harvest celebration in Franklin, Tennessee, where he could ride a horse for the first time wearing a dinosaur outfit. Is that just not awesome living in life, all right? And in the middle, you have Baylor. Baylor just turned 11 months, and that's our son Ryan's daughter, and she's a precious, precious little girl just beginning to learn to walk. And then on the right, you see our newest one, that's Nolan. Nolan is my daughter Malia's son, and Nolan is 5 months old. And Malia pulled out this little picture because Nolan did this face, and she said, Dad, look it. It's a mirror image of you. Like, look at the nose wrinkled. Look at the eye kind of, and look at the mouth. It's like, she said, Dad, I can tell this is your grandson, you know? But these 3 little ones give us great delight. We just spent 7 hours with them the other day because Ryan and Kendall and Eric and Malia wanted to go kayaking, so they planned this a couple months out, and it was a good day for them weather-wise so they could go. So we spent 7 hours with these 3. And when we got home, it was funny because Ryan and them were, are you guys okay? Like, are you? It's like, we're good, man. This was awesome. What do you mean, are we okay? Can we do this tomorrow? And they were like, are you nuts? You know? It's like, no, we're grandparents, Papa and Nana, all right? And so this is one of the little delightful places for me that hits the mark. And we want to continue to invest in their lives. So let me ask you this question as we're talking about enjoyment. Are you enjoying God? Are you enjoying him? Do you take the time? Is he such in your relationship that he alone is delightfully satisfying? Or is it, man, I got to read Matthew 5 because that's my reading for the day. Or is he delightfully satisfying? Does it hit the mark of inner joy and satisfaction beyond anything else in your life? And if you're saying today, actually, Dave, in honesty, no, but I want it to be there. That's a great place to be. It's a great place to be. Set your heart and say, God, I invite you to do that. Let me just show you a couple of scriptures. Then I want to show you five very practical ways that you can begin to enjoy God. So here's the first verse I want to show you. It may be familiar to you. We particularly like the second half of this verse, Psalm 37:4. Delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. Again, we like that back end in particular, don't we? But the word here, delight yourself in the Lord, it literally means, as you see, it means to take exquisite delight in. It literally means enjoy God, and he'll give you the desires of your heart. Like, how is that a lose? Right? But the essence of it, like, God wants your whole life revolving around really enjoying him. Let me show you another verse. Psalm 43:4. This is the sons of Korah here in Psalm 43. And they use this phrase, God, my exceeding joy. Not just my joy and not just my enjoyment, my exceeding joy. Can I ask you a question? Is that how your walk with God is? Is he your exceeding joy? Is he what you get up for in the morning? God, my exceeding joy. You got to remember, we have to live life in context. One day we're going to be in heaven. One of the things I don't want to do is I don't want to not know the Lord enough that when I, so to speak, see him, and of course, we'll all know who it is when Jesus comes walking up to you. But I don't want it to be unfamiliar. Like, I just need to start a relationship with you. I want to start building that eternal relationship now. Getting to know him for who he really is. He never had a religion in mind when he started this thing. He had a relationship with you in mind. We've got to remember that. All right? Let me show you another verse. And again, this one is familiar to you probably too, for many of you. This comes from the voices of Nehemiah, Ezra, and the Levites when they're talking to the children of Israel. And it says, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. And it does have a dual meaning. It means God's joy imparted in you can be your strength. But it also equally means that your delighting in, enjoying God can be your strength. And I want you to realize that when you walk through difficult times, you experience this in relationships. There are people that come around you to cheer you up, to encourage and strengthen you. That's out of relationship. God wants to do the same thing with you as you learn to enjoy him. His presence, his nearness, his character, the works of his hands. Today, I want to be able to kind of open your eyes to categories now that you could begin to look at. Now, not only is that cool that we can enjoy God, but I want you to see how he enjoys you. Look at Zephaniah 3:17. This might, again, be familiar to you. It says this, the Lord your God is in your midst as a mighty one who will save. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will quiet you by his love. He will exalt over you with loud singing. Like, do you realize when God sets his eyes on you, the love of his life, that it says he rejoices over you with gladness. Like, I wonder what that looks like. Like, is God going, yes, I get to be with you today. What does that look like? But I love this one too. He will exalt over you with loud singing. Kind of the only paradigm we have for this is birthdays, right? When happy birthday, you know, everybody kind of sings loudly over you. But I want you to imagine for a moment you sleeping in the middle of the night and your God singing loudly over you, all parts at once in harmony. God singing over you. You see, this isn't just a one-way street of us enjoying God. God actually models it for us of him enjoying us. And as we can catch just a little glimpse of that, that can't help but turn our hearts to enjoy him. God invites you to enjoy him. So let me just give you five very simple and practical ways that if you're saying, Dave, I'm not there, but I want to be there. I want to give you five very practical ways that you could begin to do in your life to help you pay attention how to enjoy God more. All right, so the first one is enjoying God's character in Scripture. Enjoying God's character in Scripture. Look what the Bible says here in Jeremiah chapter 9. It says, thus says the Lord, let not the wise man boast in his wisdom. Let not the mighty man boast in his might. Let not the rich man boast in his riches. But let him who boasts boast in this. Check this out. That he understands and knows me, that I am the Lord, who practices steadfast love, justice, and righteousness in the earth. For in these things I delight, declares the Lord. Like, it's not our might, and it's not our riches, and it's not these things we're to boast in. But he says, if you're going to boast in something, boast that you have pressed in to know me. God invites us to do that. You guys know, right, that God gave us the Bible not so that we have doctrinal arguments. He gave us the Bible to show us how much he loves us. He gave us the Bible to show us his will and his ways. But he also gave us the Bible, I believe, primarily to show us his character. If you were to look at my Bible closely, let me drop over here in the Psalm area, you will see highlighted in purple pencil every name, title, and attribute of God's character highlighted in my Bible. As I've read my Bible, I just keep saying, God, I want to know who you are. I want to know what you're like. Because if you don't know what God's like, you can't trust him. Like, I don't know if you've thought about it like that, but you can't trust somebody. If I'm at the beach with Bill and I have a $100 bill in my pocket and I'm going to go swimming and I don't want that thing to get wet, I have no problem just saying, hey, Bill, can you hang on to this? But somebody in this room, I'd lean towards trusting you because you're here today, but I don't know you. What if you just say, sure, Dave, I'll watch it for you, and then you're out shopping for a new shirt or top? See, when you trust somebody, and like, we're talking big deal stuff here, trusting somebody with your life, with your eternal salvation, that one day I will breathe my last. I have put my full trust in the Lord, that when these eyes, so to speak, close for the last time, then they're immediately open, and there's this bright light, and there's Jesus, and it's like, this is awesome. Do you understand? That's like, I'm trusting my entire eternity to the truth revealed in here. If I don't know who it is that's talking about that, it's here's open. God wants us to know him so we can trust him. And so he wants us to know his character. Skip the next slide and go to the next one. Enjoying God's character in Scripture. Let me just show you, this is an example of some of the attributes. This is like, there's 40 of them. 44, I think, exactly, of them. But it's like we're just barely touching. And I don't know what happened with Savior going rogue over there. But maybe it was just supposed to be highlighted for you today, all right? But see, God wants us to pay attention to his character. And I've enjoyed a process. If nobody else ever listens to it, it was for me. But I because I wrestle with people's understanding about God, I see because they don't know what God's like and they don't trust him, they make choices based on that. And I hate the results. So I've just finished a 366-day, two-minute video devotional on the character of God where I cover 101 attributes of God's character. So you could take 2 minutes a day and for four straight days focus on faithfulness. And just, well, one of the ones that meant much to me as I was kind of, you know, because I had to prepare for each of these in my own heart and it stretched me, was how the Bible calls Jesus the man of sorrows. And how, like, for example, how do you realize it says, and God was so sorry because of the sin on the earth that he repented that he'd even made man. He was sorry. He looked at the earth and was like, could you imagine the sorrow of his heart? Which means he can understand you when you're walking through sorrow. But if you don't know that about God, you don't invite him in there. You know, Jesus said, blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Do you know that if you don't mourn, you'll never be comforted? He's the God of all comfort. Is that one up there? First one. Wow. All right. He's the God of all comfort. He's the comforter. Like, let me just ask you something. When you lose your job, when something bad happens, what do you go for to get comforted? Do you ever consider turning and saying, God, I need you to come? And then God will bring people. God will bring situations to comfort your heart. But one of the ways that you can begin to enjoy God is see his character in the scriptures and then begin to make it real in your everyday life. To begin to connect the dots and realize, look, he just brought some people alongside to help me. He was shepherding me. Okay? He was comforting me. Or when you didn't get something that you deserved, that's called mercy. Do you ever just stop and go, God, I just realized you intervened with your mercy, and I just want to say thank you. But this is one of the ways we begin to enjoy who God is and how he interacts in our lives. Let me show you a second one. The second one, and I want to read to you a couple of portions of scripture here. The first one out of Romans 1:20. This is enjoying God in his creation, all right? For his invisible attributes, namely his eternal power and divine nature, have been clearly perceived ever since the creation of the world and the things that have been made. Then he says this in Genesis, and God saw everything that he had made, and behold, it was very good. Like those of you that have recently become parents, do you remember how much you fussed about the nursery in your home, your child's new room? Just the right crib. And the right kind of lighting and the right color paint, blue, pink, yellow, you know, whatever we decide, you know. And you're fussing over the rocking chair just to be right and to make sure the clothing that you're new. And then what about that blanket? Because you don't want it to be rough. Oh, yeah, fuzzy, soft, you know. Do you remember how much you fussed about that? Have you ever connected the dots that as God was making this world, he created this specifically for you and me? It's not just some random molecules. And here's the big oak tree and the beautiful ocean. He made this so that when you would look at it, you would take great joy. You would take it in. And again, you guys, to be honest, we are so blowing and going in life that we're missing out on enjoying God. Now, that doesn't mean we stop being faithful in our jobs, but it does mean that when we make our priorities right, seek first the kingdom. Seek first God in our lives. See, because then it's almost like we become robotic. We know how to do our job. We know how to get there. We know how to put on our clothes. And you're not that delightfully satisfying is lacking. Are you with me? Thanks, Bill. But let me throw this slide up. So here's some of the ways that I've been enjoying creation, all right? The beauty, purpose, and produce of the land. Like, it's just always amazing to me that you throw seeds in the ground and whoop, stuff comes up and stuff that we can eat. Back to food over here, all right? It's just, like, do you ever just pause to realize, like, look, God did that. God did that. He made it so you just whoop, water, a little sun, maybe a little manure on there, and whoop, stuff comes up. It's amazing. Then he's made animals for us to enjoy. You know, like he thought about, I think I'm going with dots on the giraffe. Stripes on the zebra. Big mane on the lion. I mean, God, it's not random, you guys. God purposely made these things that we might be awed. We might be blessed. We might laugh. So one of Barron's things now is going to the zoo. So we go to the Nashville Zoo, and he likes seeing it all. And he, you know, The latest thing that he's just been intrigued with is when we go to the zoo is those, I forget what kind they are, but those monkeys, whoop, 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 you know, those kind, and they just get loud and they all go at the same time, whoop, 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 and Baron's like, oh my God, Papa, you know, and it's like God made that stuff for us to enjoy and to laugh and to be in awe of who he is, see? And you know, and you look at these, the incredible world of sea life beneath the ocean. You know, the hills, the mountains. One for me is that second to the bottom, the wild thunderstorm. Sho and I were just in Gatlinburg, Tennessee, kind of on our way home, part two of our vacation, and we were in the mountains, and a big, huge motherload of a thunderstorm came through. and the echo. You know, and the light in it, and Cheryl and I just sat out on our little deck, and it was like we were in awe of the power and the majesty of that thunderstorm. Guys, God made that for us. It's part of his nursery. It's like, you know, for Nolan lays on his back down, and we have this little thing above him that he, you know, you just spin it, and he's like, oh, because he can't reach up yet. But he's just like, he's just watching it, you know, and then he gets intense and tries, you know, to... Do you realize that's our nursery? That's our little thing, is thunderstorms and beautiful mountains and oceans. God made it so that we would enjoy. I want to ask you, do you enjoy God through his creation? That he actually made it for you to have a smile on your face or to be stunned with how amazing it is. Remember the time, Lisa, I don't know if you were with me on this or not, but we, on the Big Island of Hawaii, you have Mauna Kea and Mauna Loa, two big volcanoes. Mauna Kea means white mountain because it has snow on the top, and Mauna Loa is long mountain because it's kind of like this, perfectly shaped mountain, and it's long. So some of the kids in Hawaii, I asked them, have you guys ever touched snow? And they look at me, well, no. I said, like, have you ever been up there to Mauna Kea? No. The only closest thing I ever have is, you know, I've had shave ice, which is they call like snow cones, you know. I said, okay. But so I'm thinking of Stanford on this because Stanford was about 2019 at the time. And so what I did, and there's no way this could happen today on the island because of all the rules and stuff. But there's just, you know, one observatory up there. Now there's tons from all over the world. But what we did is we took an old army bus and we loaded the youth group. Were you on this with me? And we go driving up the side of Mauna Kea. It's like this. It's like the tallest mountain in the world from the seafloor. And we're going up the mountain. And we got to a certain point, Mace, our bus driver, that was his name, he said, I can't go further, you guys got to get off. So we all get off. He drives about a quarter mile up the mountain, and then we catch up and get on again. It's like that was the journey. Well, we got up to a certain point, and I have a picture of me with my hoodie on and a snowball in my hand, and behind me, you see Mauna Loa. We were up so high, we passed the clouds. And I remember just like, whoa, this is... And for the Hawaiian kids touching snow for the first time, like, this is awesome. And they were doing, you know, like, no, some of that might, if you got to, you know, and I told them growing up in Minnesota, I said, there's a rule, don't eat yellow snow. It means the dogs have been, oh, that's not pineapple sauce. No, that's something else, all right? But you have moments like that. Do you ever recognize God's hand in it? Creation, he made it for you. Let me show you a third way. I love this one. Look at Philippians 2 with me. For it is God who works in you both to will and to work for his good pleasure. Here's what I want you to see. Enjoying God at work in others. Put that next slide up if you would, please. For example, do you when you see God come through for others, do you connect the dots and you just stand back and go like, God, that was amazing? But see, look at these. God intervening in people's lives, where your friend was in this situation and God came through, coming alongside those hurting, in need, or grieving, how you watch God just come tenderly, father-heartedly, touching lives, blessing people beyond their imaginations. You've been a part of that with some people in their lives where it was like the gift that they didn't know was coming, but you knew it was coming, and to watch the expressions on their faces. See, God intervening in people's lives, using ordinary people in absolutely extraordinary ways. I love when God does stuff through people's lives to help others, and they're just dumbfounded that God even used them. What an awesome thing that is, okay? And how about this one? Displaying his splendor through their unique gifts. You know, living in Nashville, where people can sing, all right? It's an amazing thing, the voices of some of the people in Nashville. And I just sit there and I'm in awe of it. Sometimes it's tenderness. Sometimes it's just the strength. Sometimes, you know, it's the power of the voice. And, you know, like you guys, you know, because of the area you live in, you're going to have people who work in governmental realms and military realms and others here. Well, in Nashville, our churches are full with songwriters and singers and musicians. It's just how it is. And so you constantly have this before you. Well, see, that's one example of a gift. But I'm just as amazed at somebody who has the gift of fixing my car. Like, that's not my thing. Like, I can put gas in it and take it to Jiffy Lube. But beyond that, you don't want me messing with my car. Maybe cleaning it, but other than that, you just don't. But some, it's like, oh yeah, you know that. And they start, hey, you know, that's the XYZ in there. And you know, it's like, and I'm going, oh yeah, 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 yeah. And they're explaining to me what it is and I'm clueless. But I just watch the work of their hands and they fix my car. And it's like, dude, how did you do that? Some of you can do that kind of stuff. Do we appreciate it when we see God working through the giftings of other people to touch others' lives? That's God. Do you connect the dots to that? Speaking of connecting the dots, let me show you the fourth one. The fourth one is enjoying connecting the dots in your own life. All right, look at these verses. Ephesians 2, for we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. And then look at Romans 8, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. Connecting the dots of God moving in your life. Look at this next slide. Look to connect these things. So like when something happens in your life, you just say, that was such a coincidence. Well, it was God coinciding events, yes, but it wasn't just a coincidence. I'm tired hearing people say that because they're not recognizing the hand of God. All right? For example, how God brought you to himself, how God's been freeing you to walk more like him, stuck places. We all have stuck places of our souls. Are you letting God free you from those places? See? Or you're growing in your faith. What about this one? Times when God has rescued you from a situation or from yourself. Did you connect that dot? God intervened. It's like God saying, hey, move out. Just clear the way. I need to get into that and help them out. But do you ever just say, God, I want you to know I see your hand there, and I want you to know I enjoy watching you work on my behalf. All right? You know, you guys, as we're talking about this, let me just say something. Sometimes in life, we think we're entitled to stuff. My own experience is this. When I was in my 20s, the Lord just, I don't even remember all the context, but I just remember the Lord showing me something that struck me so deep, it changed me to this day as a 59-year-old. And the Lord showed me that the only thing, it wasn't like a condemning thing, it was more a fact. But the Lord showed me, Dave, the only thing you deserve and have earned is to spend eternity away from me in a place called hell. And it dawned on me that was absolutely true because I have sinned. I've hurt the heart of God. I've hurt other people. But because of what Jesus has done through his life, his death, his resurrection, he reconciled me to God. So you know what? I don't have to worry about that anymore. I don't even have to give that another thought, which means I haven't earned it. It's not deserving of it. But everything in life then, if you live that way, it's a gift. When I wake up in the morning and Cheryl's there and she's alive and breathing, it's a gift that I get to be with my wife today. It's a gift that I get to be here with you. I haven't earned any place in the kingdom of God or in Bill and Lisa's hearts or this church to have any right to stand here before you today. It's a gift that I could suck air when I woke up this morning. It's a gift that just in a little while, these taste buds will be dancing because there'll be something I'll be enjoying on my tongue that I'm eating for lunch. But see, we've got to get out of the mentality of I'm owed something. You are owed nothing. Everything that comes to you is a gift of the grace of God because of how much he loves you. Guys, we've got to get there. You have a choice. You either function in a way where you're entitled and everything's owed you, or you realize this is a gift. And this way is demanding. This way is life is just a bunch of disappointments. This way is gratefulness, gratitude, thanksgiving, holding things tenderly, not grasping onto them. Guys, connect the dots in your life of how God has been moving on your behalf. Let me go to the last one here. Enjoying living fully in the moment. Enjoying living fully in the moment. Look at this verse here, the life of Jesus. You'll see a couple slides on it. Luke chapter 8. As Jesus went, The people pressed around him. And there was a woman who had a discharge of blood for 12 years. And though she had spent, notice this, all her living on physicians, she could not be healed by anyone. She came up behind Jesus, touched the fringe of his garment, and immediately her discharge of blood ceased. And Jesus said, "Who was it that touched me?" When all denied it, Peter said, now think about it, it says these people all around, imagine the scene, a busy street, people all around, it's Jesus and people all around him. And so people are doing this and touching him, and all of a sudden this happens. This woman touches him. And then Peter says, "Master, the crowd surround you and you are pressing in on you." But Jesus said, "Someone touched me, for I felt power going out of me." He could have just walked on. And the disciples were like, "Hello," like everybody's touching. And he's like, no. He was present in the moment. Present. So look what happens. And when the woman saw that she was not hidden, she came trembling, falling down before him, declared in the presence of all the people why she had touched him and how she had been immediately healed. And he said to her with tenderness, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace." Guys, do you know how much we miss because we don't live in the present? Put up this next slide, if you would. Let me just kind of close with this. We live in a world of tremendous distraction. Have you noticed this? Tremendous distraction. Do you know how robbed you are by not living fully in the present, in your relationships? It's just about getting the job done, man. Come on, we just got to get it done. Do you know how many people there are who are retired today who are lonely people because they got the job done? They even got their bank is all taken care of. They don't need another dollar in life, but they are the loneliest people in the world because they never paid attention to the relationships around them. Do you pay attention in the moment with what God's doing? Let me give you some thoughts here. Our lives can subtly default to being more about pursuit rather than presence. Is your life more focused on the pursuit of my job and climbing the ladder and knocking them off and position and fame and power? Are you about the pursuit or are you about God's presence? Here's a little secret. When you pursue his presence, he begins to provide other ways for you. Opening doors, blessings of relationships. But when you make it the pursuit and you leave him out, guess who's kind of working on their own? Even as much as you pray for God to bless what I'm doing. It's not how the kingdom of God works. That's not how disciples live. Counter the world's tendency of what's next and what's new by living fully in the moment God has given you. It allows you to engage God, enjoy his character, and see what he's up to